I stand firm for our soil. Liquor rock and falls in the juicy. Dress me up in stitsy. Hell is round the corner.
Hi, class. So your readings this week did a great job of explaining the how and why of morality from an evolutionary perspective. And I don't want to rehash much of what those readings talked about. But what I do want to underscore is one process which was implicit, especially in the Haidt paper, on how evolutionary psychology works. And morality is a great example of that process. Now, to explain that, I want to go back in time just a little bit to one of the early progenitors of evolutionary psychology. And that was the Harvard entomologist E.O. Wilson, who spent about 50 years at Harvard studying the cooperative behavior, the social behavior of ants. Now, E.O. Wilson is considered the founder of the field of sociobiology. He wrote a book called Sociobiology in the mid-70s. And the idea that Wilson had is just as evolution can explain the antennae and legs of an ant, it should also be able to explain the social behavior that he was so fascinated in. And so the basic structure of how sociobiology would work was that evolution would select for social behaviors that maximized fitness. There would be a social behavior which increased fitness, and as a result, that social behavior would be selected for in the next generation. The reason we don't talk about sociobiology as much, and we do talk about evolutionary psychology, is that when evolutionary psychology rolled around in the 80s and 90s, it pointed out a serious missing element to sociobiology, to this structure here. And that was the idea that what's selected for is not actually a behavior, because it's hard to select a behavior. Behavior is sort of a verb thing you do. It's hard to select running. But you can select the underlying physical elements which give rise to that type of behavior. And so what evolutionary psychology did is it posited that there is a cognitive module or something that's happening in the mind usually, which is what's motivating the type of behavior, which is ultimately increasing fitness. And what then gets selected for into the next generation is not the behavior itself, but whatever it is that actually motivated that behavior. Now, this is probably best explained with an example. So let's do that now. So if what fitness is raising children to survive to reproductive age, how do you do that as a parent? Well, the behavior that you would engage in is raising children, feeding them, clothing them, teaching. It's actually a very complicated thing, and it has to be somewhat flexible to the environment that you're looking at. It's not simply run fast away from a predator. It's, well, do whatever is important, do whatever is necessary to make sure that this kid survives and is reasonably well-formed. As a result, what actually gets selected for is not the any specific behavior, go to the bay, buy diapers, whatever, but a more general motivational, emotional force, which is love the kid, motivate the parent to love the kid, and then the parent is going to be motivated to engage in whatever behavior is actually going to lead to what's best for the kid, hopefully. And so what gets selected for is not the actual behavior, but the cognitive module, the thing about the mind, which motivates the types of behavior which are going to ultimately increase fitness. In the context of morality, and this was what Haidt was arguing, the behaviors which actually lead you to be a successful, reproductively successful member of the human species are things like cooperation, engaging in reciprocity, which is something that Christakis also talked about, reputation management, making sure you're doing the right thing. If those are the behaviors that are going to lead to fitness, what are the cognitive modules that motivate that particular behavior? Well, in Haidt's case, he was talking predominantly about the moral emotions. So, for example, if you outfit an organism, say me, with a sense of gratitude to feel compelled to do something nice for somebody who's done something nice for me, then what you've done is you've provided the organism with a motivational push in the sense of an emotion in order to get them to engage in reciprocal behavior, which ultimately will allow them to be a good member of the group and be somebody who's not shunned, ostracized, but is actually accepted, respected, and hopefully has reproductive success within the group. If you outfit an organism with a sense of shame or guilt when they do something that is perceived to be immoral, then what you've done is you've outfitted them with a negative motivational force to avoid that type of misstep in the future and to pursue reparative behaviors, which will actually make sure that they're put back into good standing in the group. And so again, what you've done is you've selected for these cognitive modules which motivate people towards the behaviors that's going to allow them to be most successful. All right. So humans have then become the species with this most complex suite of moral emotions to engage in a very complex array of behaviors, which we could consider moral. Humans are the organism that does stuff like this. Humans are the species of sportsmanship. Humans are the species of alloparenting. Humans are the species of volunteering at soup kitchens. And even from a more mundane sense, humans are the organism that can sit quietly and peacefully on a plane together for 8 hours at a time. This is an example that was put forward by Sarah Hardy, that if you put our closest cousins, the chimpanzees, on an airplane together, 80 of them, for 8 hours, when the plane landed at Heathrow, all you'd have is a bloody mess. They would not be able to survive in that peaceable state. Somehow humans have managed to do so. We are the species that's able to engage in this type of peaceable moral behavior. But we're also the species of this, and we're the species of this, and we're the species of this. And this juxtaposition between the peaceful, cooperative, moral species and this incredibly aggressive, violent species is what the anthropologist Richard Wrangham calls the goodness paradox. How is it that we can be both of these, an incredibly non-violent compared to our cousin species, and an incredibly violent species at the same time? The answer to that question lies on disentangling two different types of aggression. And what Wrangham argues is that we've had a decrease in what he calls reactive aggression. Reactive aggression is the spontaneous violence that tends to be provoked in moments of threat. You fly off your handle and fight a guy who bumped you in line at the supermarket. That's reactive aggression. You see that type of aggression a lot in other mammalian species. That's the type of aggression that's involved when chimpanzees get in just fights between the two of them. You see this. This is red deers. They are being motivated by reactive aggression when they get into these mano-a-mano competitions. And for red deer, something between 13 and 29% of all male deaths are attributable to this type of violence. Now, if human beings had that same level of reactive aggression, then every year in Vancouver, there would be about 4,000 homicides. Instead, last year, there were 10. So humans have managed to tamp down considerably their reactive aggression. At the same time, though, we've ramped up what he would call the proactive aggression. This is instrumental violence, planned violence, violence that has a particular goal that you think about and you prepare for. And so here's the murder of Caesar by the Roman senators, something that was pre-planned and executed with great deliberation. Assassinations like this are a great example of this cold, methodical, rather than hot and impulsive type of violence. And it's something that we see much more in human species than we see in other species. You tend to see it a little bit in chimpanzees or wolves, but humans have taken it to an entire new level. So why is it that reactive aggression has decreased while proactive aggression has increased? Wrangham argues that this is part of the same process. Now, before we get to that process, let's take a detour to talk about human self-domestication. We talked a little bit about this in the homosexuality lecture as one of the potential explanations for why homosexual behavior would evolve in humans, or at least be maintained in humans. We also talked about how humans underwent a massive expansion in the cranial capacity of the skull in the last 2 million years. And though that seemed to have peaked about 100,000 years ago, that doesn't mean that we didn't see any other evolutionary changes in even our skulls, let alone our psychology. If you look at Homo sapiens skulls from about 100,000 years ago compared to Homo sapiens skulls today, there are some notable differences. So what you can see here, on the left, you have a 100,000-year-old African male member of our own species, and here you have a more modern one. You see you have much more pronounced brow ridges on the left. You have a much bigger jaw, generally a longer face, and a generally wider face. So if you compare these, you see that the modern male has a narrower face, has a generally more feminized face. And you could say, well, maybe it was this particular male, but these scientists in the study looked at thousands of skulls and noted that this is a systematic difference, something which has really changed over the last 100,000 years. Basically, our skulls have become more feminine and juvenile over the last 100,000 years. Now, what's going on there? Why has that happened? Well, interestingly, the changes that we've seen among humans parallel some of the changes that we saw in that experiment on the Russian foxes that I told you guys about last class. So if you recall, 45 generations of foxes were selectively bred such that only the 20% of them that were most willing to approach a human, that were tamest, were bred into the next generation. And compared to a control group that was bred randomly, you saw that this tame version went through a suite of changes that made them what we would call domesticated. They were highly willing to approach humans. They became more juvenile in form. The sexual dimorphism between the males and the females shrunk. They became more playful. They got floppy ears. They had a shorter tail. Interestingly, what happened in 45 generations for the foxes is a constrained version of the evolution of dogs from wolves. That's been a process which has been going on for about 15,000 years, but follows the same sort of idea. The various individuals of foxes who were most willing to approach humans had a selective advantage because they were able to feed off the scraps of humans 15,000 years ago and kick off this great relationship between dogs and human beings. Eventually, humans started artificially breeding dogs for particular characteristics, which is what's turned them into these little love machines. But you see some of the similar changes whereby they become more juvenile versions of themselves. Sexual dimorphism shrinks, ears go floppy, and the tails got waggier. Interestingly, that also happened to the foxes. They developed waggy tails as well, which is a social cue. But what's most interesting about this is that this is the same process that is proposed to have been what humans went through as well. So you can see that we went from this sort of brutish looking guy on the right to the more juvenile, feminized version of us on the right. Also note, by the way, the scleras of the eye going from dark brown in on the right to white on the left. Same process which happened between wolves and dogs. If you look at primate species, of 92 primate species, only 8 or 7 have white scleras. Most of them have dark scleras. Think about what that does in terms of our ability to communicate cooperatively with each other in terms of gaze direction. Anyways, this suite of changes has been called domestication syndrome. And it's characterized by, as we've talked about, reduced sexual dimorphism, with the males becoming more like the females rather than the females becoming more like the males, presumably because there's reduced intrasexual competition. We talked about how the differences between males from females is typically due to the necessity of males to fight off other members of their own sex. And the sexual dimorphism thus emerges on those features that they used to fight. If it's upper body strength that they used to fight, you see a bigger difference between females and males in terms of upper body strength. If it's the canines that are used to gnash at each other, you see bigger differences between the canines between females and males. In dogs, the canine difference between females and males is much smaller than that between males and female wolves. You see a subdued stress response, which seems to be mediated by higher levels of serotonin, which you see in the domestic version of the fox. You see in dogs compared to wolves. And you see in bonobo chimpanzees compared to their more aggressive, violent chimpanzee cousins. This also seems like it's motivated by lower testosterone. And in fact, the changes in skull shape seem to be associated with reduced androgen receptors, so reduced male hormone receptors, suggesting that we have decreased in the amount of testosterone reception in the male body over 100,000 years. And then finally, there's the increased tolerance of humans' play and pro-sociality. That's clearly true about dogs, that's clearly true about foxes, but it's suggested that's also true about humans. We became more tolerant of each other and more willing to engage in pro-social behavior. So how did all this happen? This is where we get to the quote that started the lecture. Human life in communities only becomes possible when a number of men unite together in strength superior to any single individual and remain united against all single individuals. If you look at the gorilla, we separated from our common ancestor with them about 10 million years ago. And what you see there is pronounced sexual dimorphism. We talked about this before, pronounced polygyny. What happens is that the male who dominates is always the largest, strongest one, because that longest, largest, strongest male can always outcompete any other individual male. But what happens for humans is because we can cooperate, because we can band together with other members of our group, even the strongest individual male is not a match for the coordinated efforts of other males. And that's what you see in the case of Caesar, overwhelmed by a number of his other senators. And so what happened in humans is the selection for the single biggest male was curtailed by the fact that that was no longer the unique advantage that it had always been before. So specifically, this was kicked off by the process of language. Language allowed for a type of time travel. And what do I mean by that? Well, language allowed us to be able to communicate about things that happened in the past. That wasn't possible before. So if there was caveman Dave who would force himself upon women in the camp, now you'd be able to hear about it. It wouldn't be something that you could only experience yourself and then could communicate to no one. Now the past continued to matter into the future for other people. But language also opened up the future because it allowed us to plan. And so that was the second stage, the ability to coordinate future plans, to engage in premeditated violence that you guys got together and made a plan for. And what that allowed for, according to this particular theory about the goodness paradox, is for tyrannicide, which is that if there were people like caveman Dave, if there was some dominant individual who wasn't engaging in ways that were beneficial to the group, a bunch of men could get together and kill that individual. And so that changed the selection pressures now. It led to selection against the reactionary type of aggression that would make enemies within the camp. Because even if you were the strongest, toughest guy, if you engaged in that kind of jerk-ish reactionary aggression, you could still be taken down. In fact, you probably would be taken down. And at the same time, it selected for proactive, cooperative aggression, because that now became a tool which was particularly useful. And so we became self-domesticated. We became a less reactive, subdued, more patient, more tolerant version of ourselves, at the same time as we became these excellent proactive planners who were able to engage in the type of proactive aggression that we talked about at the top of the class. By the way, that's the seal of the Commonwealth of Virginia in the United States, Sic Semper Tyrannis, death to all tyrants. And you see there Lady Virtue with her a foot on the chest of a dispatched tyrant, the king. So note the similarities here between the process of self-domestication that we pulled ourselves through and the domestication of the foxes and wolves that we talked about before. Though what we were doing with them was a process of artificial selection, of selective breeding, where we were allowing some of the species to breed and disallowing others, that's actually very similar to what we were doing for ourselves. We were disallowing those who were most reactionarily aggressive, who had the characteristics that we deemed to be most threatening to the group, we were disallowing them from breeding. And so evolution was still working by making us more fit to our environment, but we weren't talking about the physical environment as much anymore. We were talking about making us fit to a social environment. So from this point in our development onwards, and for what we're going to be talking about now for the rest of the course, what we were actually adapting to was us. I trust the judgment from my labor.